here at this Hindu temple in South London. Now you see, you mostly come from the Christian tradition, and you heard, of course, about this idea of polytheism, lots of gods and goddesses. You also heard of idolatry, worshipping objects and images. And of course, you heard of paganism, worshipping nature, looking after, and no, even worshipping animals. Now you come to a temple where the central deity has got an elephant head. So you've got all three, polytheism, idolatry, paganism, roll into one. And how do you deal with it? Well, with a great deal of cool. What I propose to do is in the next half an hour, remove serious misconception that a lot of people have about Hinduism. Not only people who are non-Hindus, even Hindus themselves struggle with some of this complexity of this religion. So I'm hoping to tidy up the image of Hinduism in the next half an hour and replace it with some of the most dynamic aspects of this religion that are very relevant in our times. This is a major shift from what you just seen. Only these lots of gods and goddesses, weird-looking gods and goddesses with six arms and all that. Suddenly all needs to be replaced to tackle the issue of the relevance of Hinduism in the modern world today. Let me take you on a quick journey. First of all, at a first glance, Hinduism appears to be surely a polytheist religion. And when you ask any of the people in the temple, do you have many gods? They'll go, yes. Are they almighty? Yes. Are they ultimate? Yes. You say, oh, this, there's a bit of a contradiction here. You can't have more than one ultimate, surely. But then it's not ultimate enough. We need to go a step further. So what is going on here? What appears as a naive polytheist religion is in fact and has always been a very majestic, pluralistic tradition. Pluralistic tradition. What's the difference? It doesn't say there are many ultimates. It says there are many ways to relate to the ultimate. This is called pluralism. You may say, well, gee, no, we studied theology. This sounds more like a relativism. It is not a relativism. It is pluralism. Let me just tell you what's the difference and how important this idea is in the modern society. First of all, let me tell you how I present the idea of pluralism to little children. I'm invited to go to lots of Church of England primary schools. I say, Mr. Lakhani, talk about Hinduism to our children. I say, with greatest of pleasure. Sometimes I have 300 little children, English children, Christian children, sitting cross-legged, listening to the stories of Hinduism. I say, my question to my chaps is this. Do you like to think of God like your daddy in heaven, like your father in heaven? And all the children look at each other saying, seems like a trick question. What is he all about? Yes, they say, God of our father in heaven. Yes, we like to think of God like the daddy in heaven. That's what mom said. I said, good idea. Many Hindus too relate to the idea of the ultimate reality as a super personality, as a male personality, and relate to God as a father in heaven. Many Hindus do subscribe to the same idea. But you see, there's always this little chap in the corner who keeps tugging my sleeve saying, no, I don't want God to be my daddy. Why not? That's such a lovely idea. No, I don't want God to be my daddy, says the little chap. What's your problem? You see, it explains. Last night when I was having supper, while I was eating, some food fell on the floor. And my baby daddy saw it and he came waving his finger at me. Naughty boy, no supper, no TV, go to your room. And I was crying. And then my mommy walked into the room. She saw me crying and she said, come here, my baby. And she gave me a hug. And she gave me a jam donut. So my question, says the little boy, is this. Why do I have to think of God like my daddy in heaven? Daddies are so rough and tough and so hairy. Why can't I think of God like my mommy in heaven? Kind and cuddly and soft and hopefully less hairy than daddy's. Why can't I think of God like my mommy? Hindus say, you would like to think of God like your mommy? Go for it, my boy. God is your mommy in heaven. This is called pluralism. It is not a gender issue. It reflects the crucial idea that when we wish to relate to the absolute, We will make do with the relative frame that we possess. We cannot jump out of ourselves and relate to the Absolute. We will use our relative framework to relate to the Absolute. This is what pluralism is about. It recognizes a variation of approaches in spirituality. Pluralism. So now when you talk to a Hindu and say, are you saying there are many gods or there are many names of the same God? They say, oh no, that's what we meant. Many names, same God. Idea of God. You know, approached using variety of different approaches. This is the central idea of the Hindu tradition. You might think Mr. Lakhani must be manufacturing this because the world is such a global village and you require these kind of new ideas. Surely you have manufactured pluralism. It is surely just apologetic polytheism. It's nothing of the sort. Go back to the right ancient scripture of the Hindus, the Rig Veda. Lovely verse. And you see how what's the power of this verse. It says, Ekam Asat Vipra Bahudha Vadanti. Same ultimate, thought of and approached differently by different individuals. Pluralism is the heart, is the throbbing heart of the Hindu religion. Now, why do you think it's such an important concept, and why am I promoting here so kind of in a light-hearted manner? Let me tell you why. Again, let me use metaphor. You see, Hindus are very good at storytelling. Sometimes we get lost in our own stories too, and we can't distinguish reality from storytelling. That's part of the game. Let me do another story to show you the power of pluralism. Two little boys playing football. They're both, you know, are best of friends, kicking the ball about. And while they're doing that, a conversation arises. One boy says, you know, my mom is the best in the world. The boy says, your mom is the best in the world? Ha! Nonsense! My mom is the best in the world, she cooks the best food. There is something very primitive about mommies, food, and boys. Even grown-up boys, if you criticize their mommy's food, you know what happens. My mommy cooks the best food, said the boy. Your mommy? Huh. You brought those homemade cakes last week, they were like rocks. Your mommy is rubbish. Boys will say like that. The moment they say, how dare you? Both the boys love their mommies. They say, I told you my mommy is the best, no one good. You better agree with me, otherwise I'll thump you. And boys being boys, they like to resolve differences physically. They're very quick at that. In no time, they are thumping each other, whacking each other, both bleeding, both love their mommies. They're both bleeding and they're thumping each other. A wise man may be passing by saying, what's your problem? I told you my mom is the best. Okay, calm down, both of you. Let me give you a resolution. Say with all the love and devotion you can muster. Don't hold anything back. My mommy is best. But add two magic words at the end of your sentence. The boy said, magic words? What are the magic words? Say with all the love and devotion, my mom is best for me. The boy said, that's exactly what we meant. My mommy doesn't know this chap even. Ah, you resolve in two ticks. They become best of friends, start playing with the football straight away. No problem. A simple metaphor with a very powerful message, and I thump it in at every theological college I go to. I say, see, learn from these little boys. Assert with all the love and devotion you can muster, my religion or my sectarian movement or my movement within my own religion is the best. But add those magic words at the end of your sentence. For me and my congregation, not necessarily for the rest of mankind. You see, when I say it, people shudder. They say, he's really stepping into our territory here. Our mommy is really absolute mommy and everybody's mommy. See, it is a very serious message that I'm putting through using simple metaphors. It is so necessary in modern times to recognize these very mature teachings at the heart of the Hindu religion, which says, please be devout in your own faith. We are not saying pluralism doesn't mean mix and match, means become a Buddhist in the morning, Muslim in the afternoon, and Hindu in the evening. Don't do that. You demolish the credibility and dignity of all the religions. It's not a mix and match situation. It doesn't even ask you to go shopping for religion. You know, in the modern times, it's a kind of idea. Go in the supermarket, okay, this Zen thing sounds good for me. It says, don't do that. The pathway that you are born in, that fits with your own background, fits your digestion system, follow it to the destination. Take it to its conclusion. Do not worry about the prescription of other people. You have your prescription. Follow it to the letter. Follow it to its destination. And the reason why this is not relative, because the theologians say, yeah, this sounds like relativism. It means anything goes. I say, it's not relativism. Do you know why? Because the prescription it offers you is binding. If you are a Christian, the Christian prescription is binding. If you are a Hindu, that prescription is binding. That is why it's not relativism. Let me show you an example. You see the power of this teaching. Suppose I want to come out of this room and I have to go that way. And I decide on my prescription, I take out my compass, oh yes, north by northeast, take 10 steps. If each and every one of you wanted to come out of the room and you pointed at that particular doorway and you looked at your prescription and compared it with your neighbor, forget about with me, with your neighbor, you had this slightly different prescription. And you may all say, oh, by looking, comparing our prescription, it appears anything goes here. We all seem to have different prescriptions, each, every one of us. Is this relativism? No. Because the prescription you have is binding. If you follow my prescription, you'll hit the wall. You follow your own prescription to the destination. Sometimes when I present this idea, some people challenge me. They say, look, okay, look, I know I like you, a nice chap, this pluralism stuff sounds nice and soft and gentle. Let me be very clear with you, Jay. Ours is the motorway to God. Come with us. I said, look, I wish you well. Jump in your car and go to your destination. Sooner the better. I am on a scenic route. This is my choice. This is my freedom to decide how to unfold spiritually. This is one aspect. You can see the power of this idea of pluralism. It is dramatic. I've been pushing this into the religious education in this country in no uncertain terms. And the word is becoming visible when you teach religion. The word pluralism will continue to arise. Look, the interfaith dialogue started with the language, learn to tolerate people of other religion. You thought, well, it's a good start perhaps. But think about it. The word tolerate is a concessionary title. It says, I give you permission to exist. It is not a good word to relate to other people. So the dialogue went further. From the idea of tolerating, it says, oh yes, we know the new language, Jay. It's called respecting people of other religion. Show respect. Now you may think the Jay should be satisfied by now. This pluralist Hindu should be satisfied by now. No. Not satisfied. So why not? What more do you want now? I want this dialogue to go a stage further. Not just simply saying respect other religions. You know what is the reason why I'm not satisfied? Because sometimes the word respecting other religion hides an exclusivist agenda. It is saying, look, such a nice chap, I'll pet you on your back. You can pet me on my back, we can share a cup of tea and have a cake. I know I am right and you are wrong. But I'm not going to make a fuss about it here and now. You'll find out in the hereafter. See, this is still hypocritical. The word that comes out of the Hindu tradition, central theme that pops out, pluralism. Recognize different people would relate to their spiritual dimension in their own unique manner. Let it be so. Give them the freedom to relate to the idea of spirituality in the mode that suits them. Do not interfere. If you can give them a hand, if you can lend them a hand, do so. Don't get in their way. Do not insist that yours is the only pathway. Do not have you. No, none of us have a monopoly on spirituality or the idea of God. Look, the scripture of authority of my religion, do you know what it says? It is such a humbling comment. It says, we guarantee you, not even 1% of God is captured in our scriptures. Not 1%. It's a very humbling comment. The only scripture of authority of any religion that very clearly says, this is the scribble. Spirituality is a personal journey. These are just indicators. There is no absolute thing in here. You have to discover it for yourself. Central idea of Hindus. Let me take you on a stage further in the journey. You see, again, Hinduism has been sometimes vilified as idolatrous religion, worshipping idols. Now again, check out, I'm just telling you, when you say Hindu devotee coming out of the temple, and he comes out on the street, you say, come here. I want to ask you, what were you doing inside? Did you fold your hand and say, oh, piece of marble, I love you. Oh, wood, you are so sweet. They said, no, we didn't do that. We're not worshipping objects. We said, oh, Almighty God, we love you. As we are relative, we will use relative tools to relate to the infinite. We cannot do otherwise. We recognize our limitation and we use them to the full extent. As we have to think or relate to the absolute using our relative framework, we will use every relative tool at our disposal to relate to the absolute. That's what the Hindus do when they bow down to all these deities. They are not worshipping objects. They are using objects to reach out to the infinite God. And again, you see, when I present this idea, tomorrow I'll be talking at Eton College, sixth forms, great fun. I say, we all do it in every field. Do you know why? They say, how? I say, do you like mathematics? I say, yeah, we like mathematics. Good, I say. Now, can you go on to the blackboard and write down infinity? Show me infinity on the blackboard. He said, no problem, Mr. Lakhani, easiest of things. He'll immediately walk up to the blackboard and scribble a little thing there, saying, that's infinite. I said, that's infinite? Oh, that's number 8 that had too much to drink last night. It just toppled over. This is not infinite, certainly not infinite. It's such a finite little fellow, it's just toppled over. You can't call it infinite. Oh, no, Mr. Man, don't fight us. You see, you cannot even get your mind around your mathematics or all these things unless you use symbolism. Symbolism to get around abstract ideas. And that is why the Hindus are not apologetic about using images to reach out to the infinite God. We are not idolaters. We use images very knowingly to reach out to the ultimate reality, the infinite. As we operate in the finite frame, we relate to the infinite using finite objects. We are not apologetic. In fact, every religion does it. Most of them do it without recognizing it. Suppose you are a Christian, you go into a church, you see a cross, you immediately kneel down. And it's a piece of wood. Oh no, Mr. Lakhani. I go to the synagogue and there's a little ark. And I say, can I touch it? No, Mr. Lakhani, this is sacred stuff here. I say, just a jest, wooden jest. No. You give sacred status. Every religion does it. Some do it knowingly. Some do it unknowingly. There's one final thing I wish to say before I stop and allow myself to be questioned. You see, this is, if you like, the thing that's going to steal the heart of the West in this century. The Hindus say, you can relate to the idea of spirituality in a theistic mode, ultimate reality, a super personality, good for you. You can relate to the ultimate reality in a non-theistic mode. You say, non-theistic? No theos there? How does it happen? Two major religions came out of India with non-theistic religion. Buddhism, Jainism, spiritual disciplines without reference to a theos or a creator god. But we don't stop there. You say, oh, what more have you got? We say you can relate to the ultimate realities in a theistic mode, in a non-theistic mode, and even in a non-religious mode. We say, non-religious, where are we going now? We say, every attempt by every human being, every disciplined attempt in any field, art, music, dance, drama, poetry, literature, every disciplined endeavor in any field will lead you to spirituality at the heart of its discipline. Every disciplined endeavor will lead you to discover the spiritual dimension to ourselves in this reality that we live in. Exploring spirituality in a non-religious mode. Giving dignity to people who say, I like science, I don't care for religion, I love science, it makes me one-pointed. I like music, I like literature, I like poetry. Go for it, said the Hindus. You are as spiritual as the rest of us. You don't have to subscribe and tick your name as a Hindu. You can be non-Hindu, you can be a non-religious person, be equally spiritual. Same dignity afforded. This is dramatic stuff. Unusual material. When I present this to the Western youth, they said, thank God. So we bring God in. You are allowing us the freedom to explore spirituality in the mode that suits us. There's one thing that I will also touch on is this. This is the conclusion of the philosophic conclusion of the Hindu religion. He says, what you were searching for in a personalized manner, personified manner as this ultimate reality, God, Theos, nothing wrong with it. But don't you see where is it visible most? Where is it visible? Here, not in the hereafter. When you see a living thing, when you see a human being, do you know why they are so special? The thing that is lighting them up, sparkling through their eyes, is nothing but your God. The same one ultimate reality, becoming very visible here and now in the eyes of every living thing you come across, and especially human beings. The most transparent manifestation of God here and now is us, all of us. This gives the highest dignity to humanity. It recognizes the, if you like, the divine spark in all of us. Again, you see, you come from the Christian tradition, so you might think, this is a bit of blasphemy. You know, we call this blasphemy, equating yourself to God. This is pure blasphemy, surely. Let me metaphors are very useful. One little Hindu boy came to the class and said, like it or not, believe it or not, the thing that is looking at me through your eyes now, that is God. The boy said, I thought I was a goody-goody. He's telling me I'm God. Things are improving here. The little chap went into a mood, kind of arrogant mood. He said, this is good stuff. I should have come to the Hinduism classes earlier. He's in an arrogant mood. He goes home. He's got his hands in his pocket. He goes in the kitchen, sees the most expensive piece of crockery reserved for the special visitors. He waves it in front of his mommy and deliberately drops it. The piece of crockery falls down, breaks into 1,000 pieces. The mommy, a Hindu mommy, normally brown in color, turns pink. It's not the curry. Then she turns red. Then she lifts her arm and comes near the boy. The boy, with his hands in his pocket, pulls one hand up, says, stop, mommy, stop. Mommy, do you know who I am? Mommy said, this little cheeky fellow first breaks plates, then asking, who am I? She said, who are you? Mommy, like it or not, believe it or not, I am God. Now, see, fortunately, mommy too, like it aunt here, had been to the Hinduism class. She said, okay, my second question to my boy is this, who am I? The boy learned his lines well. So, mommy, like it or not, believe it or not, you too are God. Mommy said, good, we are making progress. You are baby God, I am mommy God. There's a third lesson you've not been to in the Hinduism class, which says, whenever baby God goes around the house breaking plates, mommy God has to do a special worship ceremony of the baby God. And the boy was getting nervous now. He said, what? She has to bring the baby God near, turn him around and smack his bottom. And she mustn't leave a mark, otherwise social service board will come. Why am I lightening up such an important theme? Look, what appears as arrogance, as almost blasphemy, is not nothing of the sort. It doesn't mean that you are special. You alone are special. He says everybody is special. Don't you see? It doesn't raise me, it raises everybody. It spiritualizes humanity. It deifies, divinifies every human being. This is not arrogance. This is the heart, the philosophic conclusion of the Hindu religion. Deifying, dignifying, empowering mankind, seeing them as the spark of the divine here and now. Now you may feel, you know, from the Christian tradition, this is exotic Hinduism, surely it's got nothing to do with us. Oh yes, it has got everything to do with you. You say, where? You see, when I hear this lovely stuff from Christ, it says, if you cannot love the brother and sister you see in front of your eyes, how will you love the God you can't see? Same idea, different metaphor. This idea lays hidden in Christianity, but you can see the power of this teaching. This gives dignity to all of humanity, lifts them up. This is the power of this modern idea. Now, before you challenge me and ask me a question, let me tidy up one thing that is at the back of your mind and, you know, at the moment bubbling away, I know. You say, Jay, it's such a marvelous theory, deifying, dignifying humanity. What about the caste system of the Hindu? We never asked you that, but you, before you do it, let me do it. Let me ask on your behalf. What happened there? I mean, this is what happened there. The idea of caste, visible in the scriptures of authority, the Rig Veda or the Bhagavad Gita, simply says the following. It says, all of us have different skills, and these skills must be harnessed for the benefit of the greater society. It is simply a statement of division of labor based on ability, your aptitude. Every modern society will use the same prescription. Depending on what is your speciality, your special skill, we will develop those skills. You can then become an important member of the greater community and participate and contribute. That's the only comment of caste in the scripture of authority. I to take edXL and QCA to PC saying, how dare you teach the hereditary hierarchical caste system as Hinduism? Where is the scripture authority? Show me one. And they haven't found one so far. I said, pull it out. You can't teach it as Hinduism. You see, this what happened then? Just like any good idea, it can easily be hijacked and turned into a system of oppression. So this marvelous idea of caste, simply division of labor, turned into a horrendous, oppressive, hereditary, hierarchical caste system, we did tremendous harm to the Hindus over the last 1,000 years. It had to be, at the moment, the modern constitution of India has criminalized this distinction. You can't do that anymore. What about what happens to the caste in this country, you might think? Of course, there's a notice outside the temple saying, outcast, out. No, what happened? In just 2 generations, this hereditary hierarchical caste system has turned into a benevolent clan system, disappeared. How do you know? Ask any Hindu that you come across, any Hindu youngster. You see, your forefathers were potters. They said, yes, in India they were potters. Are your parents telling you join Wedgwood and become a potter? They said, no, my mommy said become a doctor. I'm telling you, we are starting a new caste here. It's called doctor caste. I'm telling you, I've not done the survey, but I'm pretty sure that majority of doctors in London are Hindus. They all jumped on the bandwagon of becoming doctors. Doctors, dentists, opticians, pharmacists, look around. This is the new caste. So the hereditary caste system immediately disappeared because the changing socio-economic landscape allowed that to happen. It cannot happen in the village in India. It can happen here like that. And turn into a benevolent clan system. If they want to marry within the clan, it is a matter of convenience, not because of discrimination. That is what has happened in the United Kingdom, literally within the last 40, 30 years. I think I've been signaled that I've been talking too much, which I normally do. Okay, in only if you wish to interact further, sorry I didn't get a chance, but I'll get carried away with the story of the children, because my IQ level shows very quickly. It's so important to have this interaction and present to you some of the most relevant aspects of Hinduism, which are so important to resolve the issues that we face in the modern society. Spiritualizing humanity, giving dignity to people who are not even religious. And this is the real cohesion we require. And this comes out very naturally from our tradition. Thank you for listening to me. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.